thank you for inviting me along here today. That's my precious girl behind me there. I know that my story is an uncomfortable one where there's nowhere to hide. I don't like saying these words and knowing that they're true. When I was pregnant with my daughter in 1997, I remember watching the film Trainspotting and being shocked by what I saw. The imagery within that film showed a gloomy world where people had lost their way in life and hope stood very little chance as drugs took them into the darkness. Fast forward to the image of a 15-year-old girl holding her pet rabbit Bluebell underneath a tragic headline, 3 months away from her 16th birthday. The 20th of July last year was a beautiful sunny Saturday. That was the day when what I feared actually happened and the world changed for me. I was blissfully ignorant about the world of drugs before Martha died. When I found out that she had started to dabble, I felt inadequate and out of my depth. I didn't know the best place to look for advice or how to address it in a way that would really get through to her. But now it dawns on me, I was going about it in the wrong way. I didn't provide her with reason and logic. I was angry, which showed her that I didn't relate to the world, to what she had witnessed in her life. Drugs are laughed about on sitcoms, joked about on panel shows, and given a glossy allure on teenage cult shows. Much as I hate to admit it, they are in fact a normal part of modern society. Young people witness their friends not dying from taking drugs all the time. So by simply spouting "just don't do it" and hoping that will be enough of a deterrent, we're closing our eyes to what's really going on and not equipping our young to deal with the world they're exposed to. Young people these days aren't scared like we were. We have a generation on our hands who have witnessed terrible atrocities on the 24-hour rolling media machine that exists and feeds into their subconscious. In my childhood, I had the Encyclopedia Britannica, or my Uncle John, who was a retired head teacher, to help me find answers. Today, children have the internet, a vast sea of information at their fingertips, data and imagery flashing through their young minds and permeating into their brains. Some of it is accurate and proves to be an incredible resource for them, but some of it is also misleading and therefore difficult for them to gauge what is really true. I tried to scare Martha by saying that those pills could be mixed with rat poison. That was the only ammunition I had at my disposal. Such a traditional response to my oh-so-modern child. I took her into her school to try to make her see sense. I wanted to provide her with expert advice and helpful guidance, or at least know where I could obtain that information from. I searched the internet but got lost in the detail. I talked to her about all the sacrifices I had made for her throughout her life and asked her why she would do such a thing. She simply rolled her eyes and said, "It makes me feel happy." And I barked, "Aren't you happy anyway?" She said, "Yes, but it makes me feel even happier." I was dumbfounded. She was blasé, and that made me even more terrified on her behalf. Little did I know then that she actually listened to my advice by going for the more pure option and taking MDMA in a crystalline form, which she pounded down into a powder. Martha loved life, but she was curious, and that is normal. As a little girl, I encouraged her to not be afraid to climb trees or swim in the lake. I took her around the world to immerse her in other cultures and show her what was possible. Ultimately, though, Martha was an ordinary modern teenager. Most parents will do what I did in trying to scare their children into thinking that drugs are bad. Children are getting so many mixed messages in this modern world. They hear the drugs are bad message constantly, but yet they know they are widely available. Martha's school is in North Oxford. It is deemed to be academically excellent. My friend's 12-year-old daughter told me that she'd been offered drugs within a couple of weeks of starting at the school in the very first term after Martha died. Another of her friends was offered drugs 17 times in one night in Oxford. When I think back to my school years, I think the worst thing that happened to me was that I slid through a puddle of custard in the dinner hall. I can still remember the janitor coming along with his bucket of sawdust as the dinner ladies attended to my scalded arm. How I wish that would have been the only danger my little Martha was exposed to. After Martha died, her internet history showed that she'd been researching how to take drugs safely. I've gone on the record saying Martha wanted to get high, she didn't want to die. I know that may seem controversial, but parents would prefer one of those options to the other. Martha swallowed half a gram in one go, and it turned out to be 91% pure. The world is getting used to the "another teenager has died from taking ecstasy" headline. To most, it's just another face on the front of a newspaper that within 24 hours will be fading in the recycling box. But when I hear the news that someone has died and yet another family has joined the Bereaved Parents Club, I feel helpless as I wonder how many more need to be sacrificed before someone in government will actually do something about it. Isn't the loss of precious lives an indicator of a law that has passed its sell-by date? The evidence is yet there, but I understand that it may not be a vote-winning strategy. So a mum whose only child has died from taking ecstasy once it legalised, is she mad? Shouldn't she be saying to ban it and come down with an even tougher approach? Well, I believe in safety first. Round and round the prohibition versus legal regulation argument goes, spinning in our heads. Someone in my shoes doesn't need statistics or propaganda. I stand by my child's grave. What more evidence do I need? Yet the people in power turn away from it. They play an amazing game of let's pretend, as they'd rather be popular than brave. Every day I wake up, I need to bravely face the bereavement. I can't hide. There's nowhere for me to hide. I've spoken to hundreds of people over the past year, and one thing I've discovered is that many people don't actually understand what legal regulation actually means. So we need to educate the nation with good evidence-based information on this subject and show them alternatives to what's been in place for over 40 years now. Of course, it's important to stress that we must do what we can in order to deter young people from taking drugs in the first place. However, under a regulatory model, even if drugs got into the hands of younger people, the dangers would be significantly less than they currently are under prohibition. It means taking drugs out of the hands of dealers and treating them in the same way as pharmaceuticals. When Martha's bag was returned by the police, it contained an empty packet of Marlboro Red cigarettes and a book on baby animals. A perfect visual symbol of a teenager. They think they're grown up, but they're still little. We must protect them. It's our duty to keep them safe. I believe that we need to give them good information on how to avoid overdosing. They need to know how to do it if they're going to do it anyway. Free drug testing facilities should also be widely available to enable people to make more informed decisions. As I sat in the emergency room at the hospital, my eyes were fixated on the flat line. Such a subtle sign indicating that life within Martha still existed. I yearned for a single beat. The only beat I was left with was my own. That same beat gives each step I now take a newfound certainty. Until that gentle rhythm within my own heart stops, I will go wherever the answers lie. Oops, sorry. My daily primal scream is, please help me. Please help avoid another person having to live with a loss like mine. And I don't mind who hears that. But what I would like most of all is for people to actually do something about it. For Martha is not just a story. She was my little girl, the only person who called me mum, and a great loss to the world. With that in mind, I will do whatever I can to help raise awareness of my loss in order to protect your children and your grandchildren. Thank you for listening.